from Colossians 4, verse 12 to 13, reading from the English Standard Version. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ Jesus, greets you, always struggling on your behalf in his prayers, that you may stand mature and fully assured in all the will of God. For I bear him witness that he has worked hard for you and for those in Laodicea and in Hierapolis. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you so much, Muzi, for the reading. Thank you, Josie, for hosting us. Thank you, Gladys, for a rapper of a seller. Thank you, Jake and Harmony, Tandile and Riven, for leading us in worship. It's been a great morning, and I'm really excited to open up the Word of God with you this morning. Quick question, what does this emoji mean to you? What does this emoji mean to you? Let me ask you a few more questions. What do you mean when you use it? What do you experience when you receive it? Because obviously people also use it as a reaction or a reply. What do you experience when you receive it? What do you mean when you say praying for you? Because I know that you do it. I do it too. What do you mean when you say praying for you? Prayer hands. How and why do you pray for someone? See, fam, a healthy church is characterized by mutual ministry to one another, serving each other, encouraging each other, helping each other up, exhorting each other, admonishing each other. There are dozens of ways in which we can do that as the church. I would like to put it to you this morning that prayer is probably the best way to minister to each other. Now, why is ministry to each other so important? It's because we are in the business of making disciples. Let me remind you of our discipleship triangle. At Fellowship City, we say a disciple loves God and loves people. And we say a disciple knows God, a disciple commits faithfully, and a disciple gives generously. And we say we commit faithfully to God's people. And we say we give generously of our talents. So as we serve each other, as we minister to one another, we are using our talents generously and we are staying faithfully committed to God's people. And the end result of that would be the transformation of people. Josie said it this morning, as the gospel transforms the individual life of a person, we want to see lives being transformed. And you ministering to each other and us ministering to each other through prayer will lead to lives being transformed. Now, we can learn a lot from Epaphras about the ministry of prayer. Now, we started in Colossians 4 this morning, so let's just back up a little bit. Paul. He was a leading figure in the New Testament, right? Church planter, church leader, also an apostle. Paul did not have a one-man show philosophy of ministry. Paul had friends, and those friends in the faith served with him, they proclaimed with him, they defended the truth with him, they edified the church with him. And Paul often gave these gospel partners a shout-out at the end of his letters. And that's what he did now here in the end of Colossians. So in his final greetings to the Colossians, we see some shout-outs. Paul mentions 11 people by name in verses 7 to 18. Verses 7 to 11, he mentions Jewish partners. And verses 12 to 17, he mentions Gentile partners. Paul worked with everyone. Why? Because Jesus reconciled everyone to each other as he reconciled them to God. Colossians 3:11, Paul says, here there is not Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, free, but Christ is all and in all. That means Jesus is the only thing that matters. So Paul was not into sects. He wasn't into cliques. He wasn't into tribes. Jews and Gentiles were all the same to Paul as long as Christ was exalted. So Paul had this really cool, diverse ministry team that should remind us of the bond that we share in Jesus. And that's a bond that is more than racial or political or cultural nuances, differences, and agreements. Now, one name stands out in this list of Paul, like I said, and that is Epaphras. We only read about Epaphras three times in the whole New Testament, but it's really cool to see what he did and how he did it. And if we actually study his life, I think it can be very impactful and important to us as we think about praying for one another. So, the big takeaway from Epaphras' example is that he was a man of prayer. A theologian called D. Edmund Hibbert wrote, "Epaphras holds the unique distinction among all the friends and co-workers of Paul of being the only one whom Paul explicitly commended for his intensive prayer ministry." That's crazy, huh? Now, that does not suggest that Epaphras did not do anything but pray. That's important. And it also doesn't suggest that Paul's other colleagues didn't pray. It just says that Epaphras' prayer life stood out. In the beginning of Colossians chapter 4, just by the way, if you have your device with you or your Bible with you, we're going to be in Colossians, and I don't have all the scripture references up on the screen. So it'll be helpful if you can navigate there quickly. Colossians 4 verse 2 says, "Continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving." That was Epaphras. Steadfastly continuing in prayer. Now verse 12, as we saw, says he was struggling on your behalf in his prayers. Fam, Epaphras cared about the church so much that he traveled 1,600 kilometers by foot from Colossae to Rome to go and visit Paul. And we actually don't know if Epaphras was ever reunited with the Colossians. But at the end of this letter that Paul wrote, he testifies that Epaphras was a great example of intercessory prayer. Epaphras prayed for his people. Now, here's our leading question for today. What was outstanding about the prayer life of Epaphras? Three S's. The servanthood of Epaphras, the struggle of Epaphras, and the sacrifice of Epaphras. We'll get there now. Let's pray first. Lord Jesus, thank you for your word. Thank you that your word is alive. Thank you that your word ministers to us now as we open it up. Thank you that your word gives life. Thank you that your word is a lamp to our feet. Thank you that your word encourages us, inspires us, and teaches us. Thank you that we can open up your word together in a setting like this, together as your family, having your Holy Spirit dwell in us, ready to hear from you as we've sung about you this morning and as you've become bigger in our heads and bigger in our hearts. I pray, Lord Jesus, that this word would fall in good soil and that we would be encouraged to pray like Epaphras after we've studied this word. May it all be for your glory. We pray that in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. Okay, so what was outstanding about the prayer life of Epaphras? First one, the servanthood of Epaphras. Are you with me? Let's look at verse 12. I've got highlights for you on screen. Epaphras, who is one of you? A servant of Christ Jesus. Epaphras was with Paul when he wrote this letter. And at some point, Epaphras said to Paul, "Hey, dude, tell them I say hi." And then he says, "Greets you." But before he says that, he's got these two really cool statements about the servanthood of Epaphras. The first one is that Epaphras was a member of the church. Paul identifies Epaphras by his relationship to the Colossians. And what does he say? "Who is one of you?" He described Onesimus in the same way in verse 9. Now, Epaphras was native, or he was a resident of Colossae, but one of you refers to more than his hometown because this letter wasn't written to the citizens of Colossae. This letter was written to the church in Colossae. Look at Colossians 1 verse 2. It says, "To the saints and faithful brothers in Christ at Colossae. From Epaphras, one of you. Okay, so if this is to the saints and to the faithful brothers, then what is Epaphras? Epaphras is a saint, and he's one of the brothers. And what was said about the Colossians in chapter 1, verse 4, was true of Epaphras, and that was that he had faith in Christ Jesus, and that he had love for all the saints. Epaphras was a genuine Christian disciple, and he was a faithful church member. And his ministry of prayer was not about prayer itself. His ministry of prayer was an expression of his love for the saints. He loved the church, and he loved his people. And that is why he prayed for them. You guys have heard the English saying, out of sight, out of mind. I don't see it, so then I forget it. You'll never have a deep love for the church if that's how your church attendance goes. You'll never have a deep love for the church if you forget about the church when you don't see the church. Epaphras was there, and he was part of it, and he loved the church. So never out of sight and never out of mind. And when he prayed for the church, he prayed about what was happening in the church, because what was happening in the church was happening to him because he was in the church. Do you guys see the closeness of the relationship? It's not like I pray for them, it's I pray for us, because I know what's going on in this place, and I know the people, and I love them, and that's the reason why I pray for them. So he was faithful in his membership. But then you also see the word servant of Christ. Can also be translated as minister of Christ. Now, Epaphras was possibly the founding pastor of this church at Colossae. Colossians 1 verse 7, if you can back up there quickly, it says, they heard the gospel from Epaphras. So Epaphras heard the gospel, then he started sharing the gospel, and then he planted a church. And then the church grew, which was great. And then something happened in that church, and that is that false teachers infiltrated this really young church. And what happened there was they made claims that denied the sovereignty of God, the fact that He's all-powerful, the supremacy of God, the fact that He's the Lord of Lords, the sufficiency of Christ, the fact that the price that Jesus paid on the cross was enough for the atonement of sins. These false teachers made claims that denied all of those things. And then Epaphras didn't know what to do. But what he knew was the gospel that he heard came from a guy named Paul. And he was like, I'm going to visit Paul. And I'm going to ask for some advice from Paul. Why? Because I care about these people. And I don't want them to go astray. I want this church to remain faithful. I want this church to keep growing. I just don't know what to do now. So now I'm going to ask the guy who's supposed to know. And then he did the 1,600-kilometer road trip to get to Paul. And then he said to Paul, dude, we are in trouble. This is what happened. This is how we planted the church. This is how we've grown. Please help me. And then Paul goes, I am moved. I shall write a letter. And then we will send them a letter. Paul never visited Colossae himself. And the letter also wasn't delivered by Epaphras himself. Tychicus delivered the letter, while Epaphras remained in Rome. In Philemon, verse 23, Epaphras is called my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus. And who wrote that letter? It was Paul. So was Epaphras in prison with Paul? Well, it's possible. Think about this. Paul was in prison already. And now he gets a visitor. And this visitor is said to be busy with the same things as Paul. And he cares enough about this church to go and visit Paul, but now he gets in trouble. And he was possibly in legal trouble to go and see Paul. But for Epaphras, it's all worth taking the risk. Why? Because I am a servant of Jesus Christ. I'm a slave of Jesus Christ. I'm the property of Jesus Christ. When he says, I do. And I felt that I should go, and that's why I went. And he went, and he told, and Paul wrote the letter, and Paul sent the letter, and Epaphras remained. Why? Because he's a servant of Jesus Christ. And I'm obedient to Jesus. And as a servant of Christ, Epaphras prayed for the saints. So, a servant of Jesus Christ, a minister of Jesus Christ, Paul's making the point that as Epaphras prays for his people, he is also serving Jesus through it. Do you see it? Are you guys with me? So that was outstanding of the prayer life of Epaphras. The servanthood of Epaphras. Do you ever think about praying for you, that little line, as serving people and serving Jesus and serving your brothers and sisters and being obedient to Jesus while you do it? Because that's what it's supposed to be. Okay, let's look at the second one. So we've covered the servanthood of Epaphras. Let's look at the struggle of Epaphras. Look at the highlights in verse 12. Epaphras, this faithful church member, the slave of Jesus Christ, this obedient one, greets you. He says, Eta. And let me tell you something about him, says Paul. Always struggling on your behalf, that you may stand mature and fully assured in all the will of God. Epaphras greets you means more than just hello. It means Epaphras welcomes you. He receives you. He embraces you. He longs for you. Okay, so hang on. How did Epaphras embrace people who were not present? He embraced them by always struggling on their behalf in his prayers. Do you see it? One way in which Epaphras put his arms around the church was to pray for them while he wasn't with them. Do you think about that when you say to someone, praying for you? Do you realize that's the effect that it can have? I can't be with you now, but I am praying for you. And as I am praying for you, I'm putting my arms around you and holding you and welcoming you and receiving you and making you feel loved. That's the effect it's supposed to have. That's what Epaphras did, even though he wasn't with them. And that's what Paul commends him for. And then Paul describes how Epaphras prayed for the church. Look at the first one. Always. Always. Epaphras prayed continuously. Now, always doesn't mean that Epaphras did nothing but pray. And always also doesn't mean that he had unending formal prayers. I would like to say it was regular and repeated prayer. Regular and repeated prayer. I want to ask you a question when it comes to regular and repeated prayer. How many people in your life never hear you pray? Because fam, all of us say, look, I pray. I do. Okay, when? And how? And is there anyone that can testify that you actually pray? Because that's the beauty of the example of Epaphras. Paul actually saw him. And he actually heard him pray out loud. And he saw him do it continuously. If you never pray with someone, or no one can ever hear you pray, I think that there's a massive gap to be filled in your prayer life. I'm not saying that you don't pray. I'm just saying that Epaphras sets an example of regular and repeated prayer where someone saw him doing it and someone could hear what he was crying out for and contending for. I think there's something about sharing prayer with someone. Right? Quick side road. I've stopped saying to people on messages, I will pray for you. I either do it while I talk to them. So I go, you know what, let's just take a moment now. Let's pray now. Or if I send a voice note to someone, I would go, I am going to continue praying for you and let me pray for you now. There's something about it. There's something about it that strengthens the other person. And it strengthens my own faith. Okay? Sometimes I would write a prayer. I actually prefer writing communication over verbal communication. You wouldn't believe it, but I do. Does anyone ever hear you pray? I just want to leave that with you. I think that's a really important part of the example that Epaphras sets for us. Okay, now, he's always struggling. In his prayers, and that indicates that the Lord did not just hear from Epaphras when he needed something. That's an interesting remark. Paul didn't say, always struggling on his behalf in his prayers. Always struggling on your behalf in his prayers. So he prayed all kinds of prayers. Prayers of adoration, prayers of confession, prayers of thanksgiving, prayers of supplication, prayers of intercession. And Paul says, I heard this dude pray, and he wasn't praying these things for himself. He was praying these things for you. And while he was doing it, he was struggling. So he was praying continuously, and then there's an English word that I think works. Epaphras prayed fervent prayer, struggling prayer, passionate prayer. The word struggling in Greek, which is the language in which the New Testament is written, can also mean agonizingly. Epaphras was filled with agony when he prayed for you. Agony, fam, is comrades athletes on kilo 85. That's agony. Agony is soldiers in the battlefield, bloodied and dirty, not knowing when they're going home. That's agony. That's what Epaphras felt when he prayed. That's what Jesus felt in Luke 22, verse 44, when he was praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. That's what Paul felt in Colossians 1, verse 29, when he speaks about his preaching. That's what Paul felt in Colossians 2, verse 1, when he speaks about his prayers. Paul and Epaphras were kindred spirits, and you can pull Jesus into that triangle. They stressed and they strained and they struggled in prayer. Many of us struggle at prayer. Very few of us struggle in prayer. Did you get that? Many of us struggle at prayer. Very few of us struggle in prayer. And I'm wondering, I'm asking the question, I'm not submitting it to you, I'm asking the question, is that why we do not see our prayers making a difference in our lives, in our families, or in our church? I read this quote from H.B. Charles this week, and it's a hard one, but I have to read it to you. Here's what he says. Your prayers will never mean anything to God until they mean everything to you. I'm going to read that again. Your prayers will never mean anything to God until they mean everything to you. Hectic. I didn't even know if I wanted to read that quote in my sermon. Even last night, I was thinking, should I say that or should I not? But I decided to do it. Let me tell you why. Because the emphasis is not in the first part, your prayers will never mean anything to God. The emphasis is on the second part. Until they mean everything to you. Do my prayers mean everything to me? Do your prayers mean everything to you? Hectic, fam! These are really important questions. Because those words describe someone whose prayers meant everything to him. While he took the risk to leave his church, while he asked for advice because he didn't know, while he sent a letter back, not being there, not knowing what's going on, he was in it with them. His prayers meant everything to him because he loved these people, he loved the church, he loved Jesus, and he wanted them to stay the course. Do your prayers mean everything to you? And if you say yes, then answer, well, when do you pray? And how do you pray? Because it is impossible to say, my prayers mean everything to me. But you can't tell me when you pray and how you pray. That's the example from Epaphras. So we spoke about he prayed continuously. We said he prayed fervently. He also prayed selfless. I've made that point, but let me just amplify it once more. He was struggling on someone else's behalf. It's one thing to struggle in prayer for yourself. I think most of us would know what that's like. It's another thing to struggle in prayer for others. It's a whole mind and heart shift To think of others more than you think of yourself as you pray. The saying goes in the farming community, hear not the prayer of a traveling man. Because the traveling man wants fair weather for his journey. He does not care about the community he passes through that desperately needs rain. Think about that, right? You pass through the Free State and you go, oh, we're going to a wedding there, you know, somewhere in Betuli. We really hope for nice weather. And all the farmers are on their knees crying out for rain. That's why the farmers say, don't trust the prayer of a traveling man because he only cares about himself. Do you care for others in your prayers? Epaphras prayed like a family man, not like a traveling man. How do you pray? Let's read some verses. James 5, James 4, and Job 42. Now, I can't expound all of these verses, but just read them with me. They messed me up big time this week. And I'm hoping that they'll mess you up too. In a good way, obviously. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. The Bible says what it says. Am I a righteous person? Well, according to my standing, according to my faith, yes. Does my prayer have great power or not? The Bible says it does. Do I know this and do I believe this? Let's look at James 4, verse 3. Hey, you ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly to spend it on your own passions. Think about it. If your own prayer life is a long list of stuff only for you, then that verse should be a mirror for you to stare into. James says, you're not going to get it because you're only praying for yourself. It's selfish. I remembered this moment, this morning in the shower, when I was a fresh believer, like fresh, 1 month. I prayed that Chelsea Football Club would win the English Premier League. Serious. I did. It was on my prayer list. Solid. Because I wanted it. Because I was a Chelsea fan. Because I liked Mourinho. And I liked Didier Drogba. And I wanted to tell all my United, Arsenal, and Liverpool friends. I mean, someone told me that I could ask God whatever I wanted. I had a long list. And on my list, CFC. Praying for God's blessing over Stamford Bridge. I did. And then one day, we showed our prayer lists to each other because we were all really fresh Christians. And my one mate, who's a United fan, said, oh, dude, are you praying for Chelsea? And I went, yeah, I am. And he goes, do you think that's why they're winning at the moment? I'm just asking, like, are you behind this? And I said, I don't know. All I know is, as a Christian, I should pray for the stuff I want, and what I want is a trophy, so that's what I'm praying for. I'm immature, 1 month-old Christian. I just remembered the story as I was in the shower this morning going, wow, I have grown, and also, I know what it's like to only pray for my own stuff. I wasn't praying for spiritual growth at that point. I wasn't praying for the end of racism. I wasn't praying for justice to be done in the world. I wasn't praying for the church to advance. I wasn't praying for people to experience the Holy Spirit. I was praying for the football club. And now I'm tempted to make the joke, maybe I should start praying for them again. I'm joking. A healthy prayer life is a prayer life consists of supplication and intercession, crying out on behalf of others. Here's another one. Job 42, verse 10. Right at the end of Job. Right at the end. Last chapter. Final verses. It says, and the Lord restored the fortunes of Job when he prayed for his friends. Woof. Just before this verse, God speaks judgment over his friends. And he says, you were wrong. You didn't know what you guys were talking about. And then he says, Job, pray for these guys. so that my nose won't burn against them, that my anger won't burn against them. And then Job goes, okay. And then it says, and God restored the fortunes of Job. I don't know, fam, but if I read these verses, what I see is that some things will never change until I forget about myself for long enough to actually pray enough for other people. Why did Epaphras pray for the church? So we spoke about how he prayed for the church. We said he was continuous, he was fervent, he was selfless. Why did he pray for the church? Now look at verse 12 again. It says, that you may stand mature and fully assured in all the will of God. Hectic. It doesn't say that your kids will flourish at school. It doesn't say that your businesses will be successful and you'll make a lot of money. It doesn't say that your persecution will end and that you can live peacefully as citizens of Rome. It doesn't say even that your bodies might be healed fully and that COVID will never hit you. Epaphras focused on something else. He didn't focus on physical, material, or circumstantial matters. He focused on spiritual priorities. And that guided his prayer for his people. I think that's an important remark. I'm not saying that physical, material, and circumstantial doesn't matter. I'm just saying that Epaphras focused on something else. Think about this. If I would go around the room now and ask you, what can I pray for you? Sometimes we send that out on the news group and say, how can we pray for you? I understand that there are pressing physical, material, and circumstantial things. I understand that. I was just wondering this morning, what would it be like if we would say, I'm currently reading Exodus, and I'm struggling to understand the design of the tabernacle. Please pray for me that I would understand it, that I would see God in it, that I would think of the beauty of worshiping Him in that tabernacle, that I would think of the Israelites' patience as they were building this thing and getting all the resources together. Please pray for me for that. Would we laugh? Or would we actually consider that serious? Because in the context of spiritual priorities, that's actually a very serious prayer. I'm not taking the mickey. There's something that's more important than everything else that I'm worried or stressed about. And that is that I'm grappling with this spiritual thing. Or what would it be like if we would give the mic and you would say, I am done with suffering. I can't take suffering anymore. And I need God to strengthen me. That's what I want. While you say all of those things, all your physical, material, and circumstantial things will still be there. But there's a priority to the spiritual things that Epaphras focused on. That's why he prayed for the church. He prayed for their stability. He prayed for their maturity. He prayed for their certainty. He prayed that they would stand. That they wouldn't stumble. But they would be firm in their beliefs. He prayed that they would stand mature. Just follow the highlights with me. He prayed that they wouldn't be persuaded and convinced by false teachers. But that they would know. Look at it. Fully assured in all the will of God. Let them know the gospel. Let them believe the gospel. Let them experience the gospel. Let them share the gospel with one another. Let their understanding of the gospel deepen. That's what he was praying for them. I'm just paraphrasing that into my own words. Why? Because the gospel of Christ is the will of God. That's why He sent His Son, fam. That's really important. What is the will of God? Grand question. The answer is that all people would be reconciled to Him through His Son. So that He can live in union with all people again. So that heaven and earth can become one. So that we can go back to the paradise. So that the curse of sin can be fully reversed. That's God's will. I understand that there are other things that are more specific in terms of what is God's will in your life. I understand that fully. But God's will is that all people would be reconciled with Him through His Son. That's why Jesus paid the price for us on the cross. That's why Jesus was raised from the dead. That's why Jesus ascended into heaven. That's why He poured out His Spirit over us. And that's why He's coming back to finish this full redemptive work of His. That is the will of God. And Epaphras was praying for his people that they would know that and that they would not forget that. That should be my prayer for you. That should be your prayer for this church. That should be our prayers for each other. Because it doesn't matter what happens to us or what we are currently going through, that always stands. Josie spoke this morning of the fact that what's the most encouraging thing to her is if someone tells her the truth. And that is the truth. And it's always the truth. That's the cool thing. The gospel never changes. You become part of it through ABC. We've said that many times. So you admit your sins, you believe in the price that Jesus paid, and you confess Him as your Lord and Savior. That's it. No qualification. It's a leap of faith after God has given you the gift of faith, and you grip it by taking the leap. It's as easy as saying, I am in. That's the gospel. Epaphras prayed that people would be strengthened in that. Now, if you get a prayer request like, please pray for my son's grade 6 math exam, it doesn't mean that you shouldn't pray for the grade 6 math exam. But while you pray for the grade 6 math exam, pray that that grade 6 boy will know the gospel and believe it and stand firm in it. And pray that the parents will know the gospel and believe it and stand firm in it. And pray that the parents will still believe that they're loved by God even if the kid might fail. That's why people ask you to pray for it, because it actually matters. Do you know what I mean? But Epaphras was all focused on the gospel. It was outstanding of his prayer life. First one was servitude of Epaphras. Second one was the struggle of Epaphras. Let's finish with this one. The sacrifice of Epaphras. Look at verse 13. For I bear witness, says Paul, he has worked hard for you and for others. All of a sudden, Paul slides into courtroom language. I mean, when do you say, for I bear him witness? You say that in a court. You say that when you testify. And Paul testifies that Epaphras worked hard for the local church and for the global church. Firstly, he worked hard for you. Once again, in the same way that the word struggle talks about strenuous labor and even severe pain in working, that's what Paul says in verse 13. That's what Epaphras did for you. How did he do it there while he was confined to house arrest with Paul? He did it through prayer. And he was working so hard in his prayer that he was mentally, emotionally, and spiritually pained by it. That's how hard he prayed. You might have heard the saying, give until it hurts. Have you ever heard that saying? People say, give until it hurts, and then you know that your giving actually mattered to you. How about this one? Have you ever prayed until it hurts? Have you ever prayed for someone until it hurts? Epaphras did. He disregarded his own personal situation and he prayed for the church until it hurts. He knelt long that the saints would stand firm. He cared for them. And I just realized as I studied this text, it's really easy to criticize the church. I think the question we should be asking ourselves is, are we praying for the church? Are you praying for the church? In Colossians 2, verse 2 to 3, Paul says that their hearts may be encouraged, being knit together in love, to reach all the riches of full assurance of understanding and the knowledge of God's mystery, which is Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. That is what I want for the church, says Paul. That is what we should want for the church. That is what we should pray for the church. That's what Epaphras prayed locally for you, the people in Colossae. And verse 13 says, he also worked equally hard for those in Laodicea and in Hierapolis. Now, Colossae, Laodicea, and Hierapolis were three major cities in the Lysis Valley. Think Pretoria, Joey's, Vereniging, like on the N1, vein. It's the same thing. Now, Paul wrote this letter to the church at Colossae. And if you look in Colossians 4, verse 16, it says, "When this letter," the one that Paul wrote, "has been read among you, have it also read in the church of the Laodiceans. And see that you also read the letter from Laodicea." Ah, there's a missing letter in the New Testament that we don't know about. It's the letter to the Laodiceans. It's mentioned in Colossians. We just never got the letter. We don't have a copy of it. We don't have a translation of it. So we know nothing about the letter to the Laodiceans, but we know in Revelation chapter 3, verse 14 to 22, Jesus warns the Laodiceans to repent. He says, "You are lukewarm." And the only other reference that we have, verse 13 also mentions Hierapolis, and this is the only place in the Bible where we read about Hierapolis. Okay, so what does all of this have to do with Epaphras? It's possible that Epaphras started all of these churches. It's certain that he worked hard for prayer, worked hard in prayer for all of these churches. So he was part of the Colossian church. However, he did not view his church to be in competition with other churches. That's a great example of how we should pray. In 2 Corinthians 11, we read that Paul carries this anxiety for all the churches that he planted and that he's involved in. We see that Epaphras has the same holy anxiety and he works hard in prayer for all the churches. The world at its worst needs the church at its best. And that's why we should pray for the churches in our city, in our nation, and around the world. Fam, you should know this of Fellowship City. We love other churches. And we pray for other churches. And we support other churches. We said when we planted this church, we want to add a church to the church landscape in Centurion. We didn't come with a prideful posture of saying, we know everything about everything and we are going to be the coolest church in the city. It can't work like that. All of us work together. We are all part of the body. We wanted to plant a kind of church that wasn't in this area, and that's why we planted it. And from the beginning, we said to all our brothers and sisters in other churches, we are here to partner. That's why we get together in a building of another church, because no one is in competition with anyone. They pray for us, and we pray for them. They want us to be blessed, and we want them to be blessed. Because if the church flourishes, then the gospel will advance. Do you guys see it? That is our posture to every church that exists in the world. And that's why we need to pray for the churches in our city as we pray for our own. Pray for the churches in our nation as we pray for our own. Pray for the churches around the world as we pray for our own. In just a few weeks' time, because we're part of Acts 29, we are going to start praying for other churches. And we'll have a slide up. And we'll have the face of a lead pastor, and we'll have a photo of the church, and we'll tell you where it is, and we'll show you on a map, and then we're going to say, let's pray now for our brothers and sisters in Uganda. Let's pray for Biswiri and his family. Let's go. Let's do it now. You'll see that it's going to change you, because we want them to be blessed too, you know, because we're all part of the same family. I almost busted out with, we are family, but I'm not going to. But I almost did. Let me end with this story. William R. White wrote a book. The book is called Stories for the Journey. And in this book, he wrote about a professor named Hans. And this professor escaped Europe during World War II. This professor later became a respected faculty member in a seminary in America. A seminary is where they train pastors. It's like theological school. And then this professor, Hans, his beloved wife, Enid, died. And when she died, Hans suffered a great crisis of faith. So the president of the seminary and three other brothers visited him to pray for him. And here's what Hans said. I am no longer able to pray to God. In fact, I am not certain I believe in God anymore. The seminary professor responded, then we will believe for you. And we will pray for you. Those four men met daily to pray for Hans. They didn't just send an emoji. They didn't just say, "Did you pray for Hans today?" They actually met and actually prayed for Hans together for months. And months later, Hans came to them, greeted them with a smile and said, "It is no longer necessary for you to pray for me." He said, "Instead, I would like you to pray with me." Come on now. Isn't that just a beautiful story and illustration of what struggling for others in prayer can mean to them? I said this in the beginning of my sermon. Let me say it again. Prayer is the best way to minister to others. Let us join the struggle together. Amen. I want to offer a few responses as we went through these 3 points, and then we'll pray and we'll respond in worship. We spoke about the servanthood of Epaphras. Maybe today your next step is, I need to be committed to this family. Maybe today your next step is, I need to do what Jesus tells me to do if He tells me to do it. Do you ever get that? Confession time for me. Sometimes I would walk past a complete stranger, and I would feel the Spirit say to me, pray for them. And sometimes I wouldn't do it. And then I would turn around and go back and go, "Hey, can I tell you a funny story? I walked past you and God told me to pray for you and I didn't. And then He made me turn around and come to you now and confess my sin to you that I should pray for you. Can I please pray for you?" Maybe that's your next step. It's just to do what Jesus says, because that's what Epaphras did. Or to say, "This is my people and I'm going to be committed to these people and I shall struggle for these people." Maybe another response, we spoke about the struggle of Epaphras. We saw how he prayed. We also saw why he prayed. Maybe that's your next step, is to pray continuously and fervently and selflessly, and to broaden your prayer requests and strike through your football team and actually put something really important in there. Maybe what you pray for should go deeper and not only the physical, material, and circumstantial stuff. Maybe that's the thing that God is awakening in you this morning. Or when we spoke about the sacrifice of Epaphras, maybe you've just never worked hard for this church. Maybe you've never worked hard for the global church. Maybe you've never even prayed for a different church than your own church. Maybe you've never even prayed for our church. Maybe that's your next step, is to say, "I'm going to grind and I'm going to work hard for this church to flourish, for this church next door to flourish, for the churches in Centurion to flourish, and then you can branch it out to the ends of the earth." Maybe that's your next step. If it is, I want to pray for you. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, it's such a privilege for us to be part of the church. This is our people. And you have brought us together. And you've called us to be committed to one another. You've called us to be obedient to you. So Lord Jesus, if that's our next step, I want to pray for us that we would have the courage to do it. That we would show up, that we would deem each other brothers and sisters, and that we would do what it is that you ask us to do. I also pray, Lord Jesus, that we would be continuously praying, fervently praying, and selflessly praying, and that we would pray for things of first importance. I'm reminded of what Gladys shared this morning, of all the things that we can be worried about, but the one thing that really matters. May we pray in this way, and may we pray for the things that are close to your heart. And also pray for our church, Lord Jesus, that we would grow and flourish, be transformed, be faithful to the mission that you've given us, that we would see great growth, new life, revitalization, not only for our church, but for the churches in Centurion, for every church that gathered this morning, for churches around the globe. I'm thinking of our brothers and sisters that can't do it with a microphone and speakers, that can't do it publicly, that can't leave open their gates so that anyone can come in. The persecuted church, the church that are forced to renounce their confession, strengthen them this morning through your Holy Spirit. Reveal to them that they have brothers and sisters across the globe contending for them, struggling for them, and working hard for them. May we be a praying church, Lord Jesus, that mean it when we say praying for you. Amen.